When you tell the internet about your cool new idea for a fun little game you could make that you're excited about, and the internet responds by coldly listing all the existing games your idea unknowingly rips off, well, a lesser man might feel discouraged. But fortunately, I am in possession of an unfeasibly large ego. So just to recap, my project this month is an idle game where you have to avoid pressing a giant red button that will murder a happy dog. And many correspondents immediately drew my attention to a Flash game called Don't Shoot the Puppy. Yeah, that's not the sort of game I want to make. It was probably misleading of me to bring up clicker games last time, which is what most things sold as idle games these days actually are. Many defenders were quick to state that clickers can actually have some quite complex number crunching that appeal to mathematically minded players who get a kick out of figuring out the formula for most efficient clicking. You know, weirdos. But it is a kind of gameplay. Also not the sort of game I want to make. What I want to make is essentially a joke game, like Don't Shoot the Puppy, This Is Not a Game, or You Have to Burn the Rope, but not just that. Not just a single joke concept that's given away by the title. No, the game I chiefly want to take inspiration from is The Stanley Parable. On the surface, an amusing spoof of walking simulators in which the player is invited to passive-aggressively defy the story that the increasingly flustered narrator is trying to tell. But beneath that, quite a sophisticated deconstructive work. I've referred to it in the past as gaming's answer to Tom Stoppard's Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead, because it's about fictional characters struggling to understand and escape from the roles they have been assigned by the plot. Not that I'm pretentious enough to aspire to that intellectual level. I might more realistically aspire to making something on the level of Doki Doki Literature Club, another game that plays with the same themes. It's not as funny or as intelligent, but it does have some very short skirts. I realised early on in the development of The Button That Ruins Everything that there was a story here. Not the story about the little dog, that's just a deliberately banal frontage. It's already fully implemented. The bar goes up, the dog goes up in rank and gets a new job, and so on theoretically to infinity, with the bars taking a little bit longer to fill with each rank. The real story is why the game is trying to get you to press the button that ruins everything. Does it just hate little dogs? Here's some story writing advice from an author of 5 novels with some pretty impressive Amazon reviews, I'll have you know. If there's a specific theme or viewpoint or any kind of abstract concept you want to have in your story, try introducing a character that embodies that concept and then use dialogue with that character to explore it. With this in mind, I have embodied the desire for the player to press the button that ruins everything in the character of a cartoon orange cat. He wants to press the button and you don't. The two of you are going to have to work this out between you, and perhaps in the process, learn a little bit more about yourselves. The goal of The Stanley Parable is essentially to see all the paths the story can take by trying different approaches with the only tool you have been given, the choice to obey or disobey. Similarly, I want my players to strategically use the only tool they have, pressing the button that ruins everything, to find unique asides in the course of the ongoing dialogue with the angry orange cat. I want to take things to a meta sort of place. I want the increasing frustration of the orange cat at your obvious stalemate to lead to them starting to examine the true nature of the situation, the way the path to the bad ending of Undertale starts exploring the motivation of the player rather than the player character. So, not much to show for the to-do list this week, it's just tell that story. Not much worth highlighting on the technical side of things either, except for one thing. You see how the words appear on the storybook page, with each letter moving into place and fading in? That was a much bigger pain in the ass to implement than you might think. GameMaker Studio's inbuilt text display functions aren't terribly fancy. You can display text, or you can not display text, that's about it. But something that's long interested me is the way games like Paper Mario 2 or Undertale add a bit of flair to their text boxes, by making individual words appear at different speeds and sizes, and sometimes moving and animating a bit to reflect that the character is using a scared or angry tone of voice. Which strikes me as a neat method for adding life and expression to dialogue when you don't have voice acting. So I'm trying to recreate it. To achieve that fade-in effect in GameMaker, I had to put every character in the string into an array and display them all individually. Bit of a slog to go through for something you probably didn't even bloody notice till I pointed it out, but the fading in thing was just the test bed. I might do something more elaborate with the dialogue boxes of the orange cat. It's nice to treat this game more as a writing project because it means I can talk more broadly about creativity rather than game-specific stuff. Oh yes, I'm not just about video games. Playing them, reviewing them, and making them only covers 99% of my waking hours. There are other strings to my bow. Did I mention I've written 5 books? It bears repeating. I identify as a creative. Obviously it's my job, but the reason I can now do it as my job is because I was doing it for years and years without pay or recognition, and as such had enough practice to get to a somewhat professional level. So if you want to earn a living as a creative, I'd say you've already got the wrong attitude. You should create for the sake of creating, not the earning a living part. If I had all the money I'd ever need but couldn't create anymore, I'd probably go mad. I know we've all had some funny laughs these last 6 months about how I'm going to drive myself mad anyway with stress and overwork, but in all seriousness, part of the reason I felt I could take the 12 games in 12 months challenge is that making games doesn't make me stressed. Well, let's not perjure myself. Let's just say it doesn't feel like work the way reviewing games feels like work. And getting the chance to waffle on about it doesn't feel like work either. Hell, I'll happily bore you to death for free. A 5-minute stretch of constant knob gags for zero punctuation can be a struggle to compose sometimes, but when I'm scripting Dev Diary, I'm more likely to fret that I'm writing too much. You see, making games is my hobby, and if your hobby feels like work, then it sounds like you've picked the wrong hobby, mate. Your hobby doesn't eat into your free time. Your hobby is your free time. So since we're talking about creativity in general, let me field a classic question that tends to get directed at creatives.
Where do you get your ideas?
Yeah, that one. It comes in many forms. Where do you get your ideas? How do you come up with all those knob gags? Since I pledged to come up with 12 months worth of original game ideas, it's been cropping up again. I don't know. I think about things and then I get ideas. They come easier at some times than in others. They tend to come first thing in the morning, in that period between waking and summoning the energy for a morning wank. But now I'm thinking about it, ideas don't come from vacuum. You create ideas from putting together bits of other things you've seen and experienced, like an idea to combine assassination and cleaning. Ideas can come from remembering feelings and emotions that art and experience has given you and wanting to recreate them. So I can't tell you what an egg is made from, but I can tell you how to create a nice warm environment for an egg to hatch in. If you want ideas, turn your mind into a great big compost heap of other ideas and experiences, and wait for the weeds to grow. Read strange books, watch movies you've never heard of. Reviewing a new video game every week for 12 years probably helps too. Get out of your comfort zone, take unique life experiences. I had the chance to go dog sledding in Utah earlier this year, that was fun, I got to feed the puppies. When I was a teenager, I went through a phase of reading nothing but Terry Pratchett's Discworld series over and over again, and it's one of my biggest regrets as an adult. When I think of all the different books I could have been filling my head with when my mind was still formative, it feels like so much wasted time. Don't be like teenage me, try different things. The mind needs fresh ideas like a gene pool needs a variance of DNA. Its absence has the same result, inbreeding and stagnation. Here's what I'm reading at the moment, The Prison Diaries of Albert Speer, repentant former chief architect of the Nazi Party. I'm weirdly fascinated with Spandau Prison, the place where the 7 high-ranking Nazis who weren't executed after the Nuremberg trials were imprisoned together. I've had this idea for the longest time that it'd be a really good setting for a comedy dating sim. Yeah, I should probably have stopped talking after morning wank.